Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you so much, Madam Secretary, for coming before us today. Like all of my colleagues before me, my phones are ringing off the hook in my legislative office. My legislative staff have become UC caseworkers, trying to do the best that they can to get people answers. And I just have to underscore what's been said already. The average time to adjudicate a claim of 92 days is not good enough. The calls that we're getting in our office, people are on edge. They are desperate. They've spent through their savings. They've gotten help from family. And they've got no options left. And so we need to do better with that. But, Madam Secretary, I know that there have been policy decisions made in this building that set our UC system up to fail even before this pandemic. I was a member of the Labor and Industry Committee back in 2016 when then gubernatorial nominee Senator Scott Wagner, to score political points in a gubernatorial race, forced the layoff of almost 500 UC workers right before Christmas. And it took us almost a year to get a funding solution negotiated, and half of those workers never came back. So my first question for you, Madam Secretary, if we hadn't laid off 500 workers back in 2016 because of political issues, would we have been in a better situation when this pandemic hit?
Thank you, Representative. I believe that we would have been in a much better situation with our traditional UC system if we wouldn't have had to lay off 500 people back in 2016.
Okay, thank you. And I have a question about what happens next. I am hopeful that we will get everyone paid. I am hopeful that with an increased supply of COVID vaccines to Pennsylvania, that we're not going to be in this situation a year from now. But I've got questions about what's going to happen to our system and to the people who are receiving UC benefits right now, whether it's traditional UC or one of these newly created federal programs once we get to the end of the pandemic. My understanding is that after the last Great Recession in 2008, many states spent down their UC trust funds. And instead of making the decision to appropriate the funds so that UC benefits could be replenished and that we could give people the benefits that they're paying for out of every paycheck, many states instead made decisions to make it harder to get UC benefits moving forward. I also understand that at that point in time, many claimants received fault or even fraud overpayments for years after the recession had ended. What are we doing now to make sure that that doesn't happen to these folks who are moving forward? Because when we've gotten calls from folks who've received a fraud payment, something they didn't apply for, or an extra benefit, they're stressed, they're still liable to pay back the money, and I'm very concerned that we're gonna have millions of Pennsylvanians in a very difficult position in the future.
Thank you, Representative. And you hit on some very important issues, one of them being fraud. And that's something that I've been remiss in mentioning throughout this whole process. We have seen in the PUA system unprecedented fraud nationally. So while we're all, you know, while trying to make sure that individuals get their legally entitled to benefits, we're fighting a war against fraudsters from foreign countries who use stolen identity information to apply for UC and PUA benefits, and it's causing huge issues with us. We're not able to get to all of our claimants because of these individuals who are fraudulently trying to get benefits. So I just want to point that out. We have contracted with a company named ID.me. We contracted with them back in October when we were made aware of this national fraud issue. So far, and just to kind of give you some brief statistics on that, so far we have sent 919,000 invites for identity verification, and so far to date we have only verified 137,000 of those 919 invites, which is 14%. So you know, there is fraud that's taking place that unfortunately is hampering our abilities. Concerning the overpayments, you know, that is unfortunately a systemic issue within the unemployment compensation issue, and it could occur as simply as, you know, we find someone eligible for benefits, then perhaps their employer comes back and says, oh, well, they didn't show up to work. They didn't leave, you know, they weren't terminated for non-willful misconduct. So, you know, we have to basically find them ineligible, and then that's how they end up with an overpayment. When it's a fault overpayment, that is when the department pursues action to recover that money. When it's a non-fault overpayment, such as something that's innocent or a misunderstanding, we do not pursue that money against those individuals. So I think it's kind of important to understand the differences between fault and non-fault overpayment. Unfortunately, it's something that unfortunately naturally occurs within the system, and it's just not limited to Pennsylvania. It's all states that experience this. And with the large number of claims that we're processing, unfortunately, it's something that's going to occur more frequently.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. I know my time is up, but I just want to say again, 92 days to adjudicate a claim for someone who is waiting for benefits they earned is not acceptable, and I urge you and your staff to do everything you can to bring that window of time down. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.